It's a prison break, escape from the dark. Can't get it out of your head. This is my world.
Turning into the night. 2020 started with a bang for the racing industry. We had six stakes races on the program from Ellerslie yesterday, and so much to get our teeth into this morning. My co-host Michael Guerin joins me, and Michael, a fantastic day and a very good morning to you.
Happy New Year, Emily, and big happy new year to everybody we didn't see yesterday out of Ellerslie. Look, it was an amazing day for a whole array of reasons. And sometimes on these shows, you think to yourself, "And what's the highlight? What are we going to talk about?" Man, there's so many. Some real highs and some lows. And we're going to try and give you some information about what happened with that really bizarre false start to the City of Auckland Cup. But we're going to start the show with a real high, because we have, this is trackside history, I think, a double phoner. So two people on the phone, Big John and Little Jason, talking about Big Julius and what was a real fairy tale to start 2020.
It was the double J's. Before we head into that dual phoner, we're going to have a little look back and reminisce at the Group 1 Railway Stakes.
Ready to see, 300 metres to go, Speedy Meaty the leader from Julius coming after, two lengths away, Winter Bride being called upon by McDonald, it's Julius in front from Winter Bride, Evelina's running on, so is Dawn Patrol, out wide of Volpe Veloce, it's Julius in front, Winter Bride's a half length away, can't get there, beat Julius, Julius wins the Sistema Railway.
Jason, if there's ever a horse that deserves a Group 1 win, it's this one, isn't it? That's just so good for all connections.
Oh, I've got to keep my emotions in check. This is unbelievable. I couldn't have asked for a better run. I couldn't ask to have a better team of supporters around me. My wife Anna, who had my diadem tracked, get me down for the weight. PJ, who rides the horse work when I'm not there. John Bell and all the staff, and just this horse is an incredible horse. He's one of a kind.
You had him in such a good position, you were always poised to pounce, but he just gave you 100% in the end, didn't he?
Yeah, I really wanted to control the race myself. Didn't matter if I was going to be second or fourth, I knew I'd be thereabouts. The speed was only moderate. I knew at the 1,000 something was going to have to be good to beat me. Could feel something coming out of the corner of my eye. He does labour a little bit in front, but a couple of big screams and woohoo, we did it!
It never gets old winning Group 1s, does it?
Oh, no it doesn't. I just don't know what to say. I'm so proud of my horse. I love him to bits, and wouldn't spell deserve the Group 1, but Jeepers, this horse is a superstar.
He sure is. Well done, Jason.
Thank you so much.
The emotion evident with Jason Waddell, John Bell, what does this mean to you?
Oh, everything, Aidan. Just to have him here was an absolute honour and privilege. So to see him do what he did against such a class field, it's just wonderful, just wonderful.
You came down here and said, "What's just happened?" It is hard to comprehend because this horse was retired 12 months ago.
Yes, he he'd done himself an injury, went out onto 3,500 acres and started tearing it up, so we thought we'd better bring him back in and control him a little bit. But just a wonderful effort, just hoping that, you know, it all stays together for the future as well.
What was the injury?
He had a little bit of a tear in a tendon, and a few little polar pony tricks sort of got him right.
Has it made any difference to the way that you've trained in this preparation?
No, we've the whole way through our philosophy was treat it as normal, treat him as normal. You know, the swimming and the walker, plenty of that type of groundwork, and just do what we like. Any fast work was for a purpose, not just for the hell of it. and he trains himself, really. You know, Jason gets on him, and or AJ gets on him, and they come back puffing. You know, he just takes them for a ride. You know. So.
And now, from that story, to have him a Group One winner, geez, it's some fairy tale end, isn't it?
It is. It's maybe a gin or two and a beer or two later on tonight, it might hit home. But just the privilege of being in here and having him here is so wonderful. That to have him back, let's hope we can keep him going, and which I'm sure we will, and maybe we'll go to Wellington or back to Waikato or whatever. But today's the day, and thanks for last year and all the support, and hopefully everybody had a nibble on him, and his fans, thank his fans. He's got a huge fan club, you know, and people coming up, and they just love him. So, and as we all do, you know, he's part of the family.
I want to enjoy this moment, John.
Thank you, Ed. Thanks so much, man.
Great to look back at the races, isn't it? And so good to see the elation and jubilation of the Strapper and Jason. And it's clear to see that they're so proud of their hard work and so proud that they could get their horse back to where they knew he could be.
I think any time anybody wins a Group 1, Emily, it's a dream come true. But I think that dream felt a long way away for Julius not too long ago, because he was retired out on the hills. We'll hear shortly from John Bell. Just the minutiae of the race, Jason handled it beautifully. 19.7 is not quick for this grade, and he just sat outside the leader, knowing he could control him and keeping James McDonald three wide on Winter Bride, and then there were no more moves, so it's not super quick. And those back in the field, willing to forgive, really good from Dawn Patrol, Evelina, pretty to see, but dominant, tactical ride by Jason. He handled it beautifully. He wanted to be outside the horse he thought would lead, and once he pretty much landed here, and there's James McDonald stuck three wide on Winter Bride, who was smashed with the bookies, in from 5.50 to 2.8. Once this happened, everything back in the field can't move.
Mm.
So it was really tactical from them, because I think Jason thought, well, I'll get Speedy Meaty, I'll out tough him, and James is outside him, and then the rest of them are basically being dictated to. So, big training performance. He's gone back from 1400 to 1200. I spoke to John about that, and we'll ask him again shortly. But he said, look, you know, he's a good horse. They can handle that. But not everybody would attempt to do that. And of course, he can go to Trentham now, but it's weight for age, the Telegraph. So he doesn't get penalised for this, because he would have been on the same weight regardless down there. I think plenty of these will head to Trentham, because a lot of them didn't have hard runs. Pretty to see, probably the unluckiest in the Cambridge Stud colours, getting out of midfield there, finishing on well. Dawn Patrol was really good, and Evelina gets a black type Group 1 placing next to her name, which will help for the Broodmare paddock one day. But that was a beautiful tactical bit of business, but you still need the horse to pull it off, Em, and they didn't have that horse this time last year, so must have been incredibly satisfying.
And as we love doing, beating the Aussies is always good too, isn't it?
Oof, it was good, and it was important for Jason, because he stood up and beat James, and had James won five races yesterday, I mean, as much as everybody loves James, it would have almost got to the embarrassing stage. So I think Jason enjoyed proving he can play with the biggest boys in the world as well, but it all comes down to the horse, and he must have a pretty big ticker, Julius, because I don't think he's got the best legs in the world.
He sure doesn't. But John Bell's on the phone. And John, as we welcome you into weigh-in this morning, thanks so much for joining us. And I suppose once again, a huge congratulations for that wonderful win yesterday.
Thank you, Emily, and good morning to you and Michael.
It was a sensational win yesterday. Have you been out to see the horse this morning? How has he pulled up? Is everything A-OK?
He's. I'm still in Auckland, and reports have come through that he's licked his bowl clean and is relaxed in his paddock. He knows he's had a race, but he is. We're very, very happy with him.
John, talk to me a little bit about the injury and the recovery process, because I spoke to you a little while ago about it, but it's so fascinating the way you turned him out on the West Coast. Tell me about that and your thought process behind that.
Well, it was... send him back out to nature to get him off small paddocks and get out into a bit of sea air, huge big paddocks, 3,000 acres or more, and he was confined to maybe a 100-acre paddock, and then was let loose on the big ones up hills and down dales where he, in the end, he was jumping around and causing havoc and chasing sheep and cattle and being an absolute nuisance. So after quite a little bit of time, so we brought him back in to to keep him out of trouble. Had him on the walker, had him in the swimming pool, and here he is today.
John, congratulations on yesterday. Was there a time when you had him back in where you thought this is a love project, but we're not really going to get him back to the races? Were there some mornings there in the cold at Cambridge when you doubted this dream was actually going to come to fruition?
Never at any stage did we think that, you know, he never showed any sign of lameness or stepping short or anything like that. Yes, a love connection. Something that we needed to, you know, there's work undone. We needed to, you know, finish off the story. So, but at any stage, if he showed any sign that he wasn't coping, he would have gone. He would have gone and been, you know, sent away again to the big paddocks. But we haven't had any issues whatsoever. We've worked him and done everything as with a normal horse, and we haven't mollycoddled him in any way whatsoever, so that we knew that we had a horse that was going to stand up.
It's probably a good opportunity to have a little chat to Jason as well. And Jason, as we welcome you and we say a very good morning to you too, and thanks for joining us. Has the dust settled? You must be pretty satisfied looking back at that amazing victory.
Yeah, good morning, Em. Good morning, Mick. Hey, JB. The dust has settled a little bit. We had some dinner with the owners last night, and me and I come home, and she was naked. She went to bed, and I think I put the replay on with Pete, so I fell asleep on the couch. So we've just woken up nice and fresh this morning. We're back off today, and we'll get back into it Friday, Saturday. But, yeah, just it was an incredible day, an incredible way to start 2021.
Jason, technically you controlled the race outside the leader. You said to me that's where you wanted to be, either there or one pair further back. You had James stuck three wide. You must have been feeling pretty comfortable at the 600-metre mark.
Yeah, I was comfortable from the moment he stepped out of the barriers. He showed the fantastic gate speed that he's got for a big horse, which is quite incredible, really. It's probably one of his best attributes he's got. The moment the barrier doors come out, it just... the race just mapped perfectly for me, I thought, and he did his job by jumping out. Chris Dell did his job by jumping and leading and not going too fast. But yeah, the fact that I was able to keep James posted wide and, you know, just make him work a little bit and didn't have to chase me down. But the easiest bit's always getting to Julius, but trying to get past him, but trying to climb Mount Everest, it's now impossible.
It's probably a question for John and Jason. What's it been like working as a team together? Because I don't think there's anybody in the world who knows Julius better than the two of you. What's that been like? John, maybe you can start.
Emily, around Bell Racing, there's no I in team. Everybody puts in, everybody gives their opinion and is checking about so we can get the right answer. The involvement of owners and so on that... incredibly interested in him. We keep everybody up to date, but to work with Jason and with all our team, as I said, it's a delight, and the horse enjoys it, and he knows them, and he knows how far to push the guys too, Julius, you know.
Jason, who's the boss? Does John make the decisions on race day, or do you make the tactical decisions, or do you let John think he makes the decisions, then make the tactical decisions?
No. John understands. I let him. He trains the horse, and I ride the horse. But when it comes down to tactics, me and Julius talk about it between ourselves. And there's not really a lot of tactics to ride Julius. He's a go-forward horse. He takes bad luck out of the equation. He's probably never sat still in the back, probably fourth or fifth in a race in his lifetime. So John understands that, and we've got a great relationship that way.
Yeah, Michael, I'll tell you something, Michael. The instructions were yesterday, go and enjoy.
Oh.
And he did just that, I'd say.
I think
looked
it worked,
enjoyable.
John.
Yeah.
Hey, Johnny, are you going to go to Trentham and enjoy yourself there? Because it's weight for age now, so you can't be penalised for winning because you're on the same weight regardless. So are you boys and Big J going to head down the line?
Yes, Jason pointed that out, that the Concorde and the Dali, which we had eyes on, probably not, well, they're not a, an option. Wellington and Tirapa are our next goes.
And a special mention obviously has to go to the Strapper as well. Great scenes of celebration there coming back to post and in the birdcage afterwards.
Well, AJ was, he's Godolphin trained, was with Godolphin for over 10 years. All the stallions around the world, Jason has ridden. He's been the track rider for two World Cup horses. And Shaq McTorm has treated him very, very well. He has an open invitation to go back at any stage, but he's staying with us. So hopefully he does stay. He's got his Group 1 here in New Zealand now. Hope he doesn't cut track and head for other pastures, but he's more than happy with being with us and learning the trade from down under.
John, we all know your colours and we know your horses and your great strike rate, but a lot of us don't know about your background. Obviously, you were involved in polo. How big has Bell Racing got? How many horses are on the property? And what's the plan with Bell Racing? Is it we want to race some horses, trade some horses? Are you here predominantly to race? We sort of don't really know what goes on in the mind of John Bell. John, so tell us a bit more.
You know enough, son, that's it. We used to sell quite a number of horses, but with the market throughout the world, it's got very, very difficult with extensive x-rays on horses and so forth that would not stop them racing, but we've ended up keeping them and syndicating them, and they've gone on and won races and been quite good racehorses here in New Zealand. So we've been very, very lucky to have a nucleus of owners that are supporting us, and we'll take shares in them. Where we're going, the number of horses, we take about 20 to 25 to the track, and there would be 10 or 15 that are in the loop as far as spelling is concerned. We try to keep it niche and don't overtax anybody as far as overworking anyone, making sure that everyone's happy and then the horses are happy. But we would really like to sell. That's the only way to sort of try and make any money in the industry. But as I say, with the world market being a little bit tight and with stake money here, it's not that inviting to come into the industry. So, you know, on the horizon, it's probably more like slowing right down and going to the beach.
Just a question for Jason before we let you go, Jace. A lot of hype in this carnival about James McDonald, and it's justified, and obviously Mick D and the Australian riders, but they are coming over here and riding predominantly pretty good horses. Did you enjoy the fact yesterday you could show people, hey, I can ride with these guys, I can ride at world class, because it's easy for us in the media to get involved in the hyperbole, but you guys still have a job to do, and yesterday you did your job at a world class level.
Yeah, thanks, Mick. Like I sort of spoke to you yesterday, we've got some fantastic riders in New Zealand. James is obviously, you know, he's won right out of the box, and he deserves all that, the accolades he gets. But, you know, he gets to come over here and he picks and chooses the pick of the mounts. I'd say he won 7 winners out of the carnival, probably had 12 rides and rode 10 favourites, you know. Look, I had a fantastic carnival and he had the 7 rides for the 3 winners. But, you know, we've got the likes of OP, we've got Vinny and Lee, you've got Michael, Troy, Sam, Danielle, Jonathan Liddell. We've got some world-class riders here that deserve the credit that they get as well. Unfortunately, we lose a lot of our club rides when James comes over, but don't get me wrong, any of the riders that jockeys in would do exactly the same job that James would do, and I think sometimes the trainers forget just the quality of rider that we do have here, and the reason that James is probably so good is because of the grounding he got with the riders that he got here. Don't for once mistake that our riders can't compete at a top class level, because they most certainly can.
And that was shown yesterday with that fantastic victory by Julius. A huge thank you to both of you for taking time out of your Thursday. I keep wanting to say Sunday, but Thursday, to have a chat with us with regards to Julius's win. A big congratulations, and no doubt we'll be seeing Julius taking out more Group 1 glory in the future.
Yep. Thank you so much, guys.
Well, there you go. That was our first dual phone.
Well, it's a bit better than I thought it would go.
Yeah, me too.
And there were kids in the background. I'm picking they were Jason's kids, of course. I met Jason's wife yesterday, who I hadn't met before, and obviously they've got the two kids and the young family. And
yeah.
Look, Jason's been through some tough times. He's struggled with depression, and riding's not an easy game for anybody who suffers with depression, because you can't eat a lot, and that'd be bloody hard. Yeah. So he's needed that support structure behind him. And I take my hat off to him. He's an unusual guy. He's a quirky guy, but it's good for the industry. He's outgoing. He's very deep thinking. I like the time I get to spend with him, and I think he's a really good rider.
And fantastic, from my perspective after the race, fantastic analysis of what
just
happens.
Just give him the microphone and off you go.
It's like, when he wins, I'm like, yes, that's great.
But John Bell was really interesting. He's one of those people who every time I see a horse of his in a race, I go, I can back this, and he's such a good strike rate trainer, but I virtually know nothing about him. So interesting to get his thoughts and what he intends to do with horses there. But really nice feel-good story.
Yeah.
Lots of good runs
fairy
in
tale.
Behind.
Yep.
Lots heading forward to the Telegraph. And as you heard, he will be heading to the Telegraph, which we're going to see Avantage head to as well. Bostonian still technically heading there at the stage. Pikey said, I'm not confirmed to go, but that's the plan with Bostonian. So take two for all of these really good sprinters will be excellent. Volpe Veloce unlikely to go. Richo saying yesterday he thought she needs up to 1,400 metres. So the Westbury, which she won last year, on Karaka Million Night's probably going to be her go. But plenty of trainers will come out of that thinking, different situation, I might have a chance in a race like the Telegraph. So the second of our Group 1 sprints is going to be really cool.
It sure is. We can have a little look at that market in just a moment. But first, let's have a listen to what the beaten jockeys said in behind Jason Waddell and Julius.
Yeah, she performed up to expectations. She ran super. Just got caught a little bit wide, but the tempo was in our favour. We were thereabouts to strike if good enough, but Julius, credit to him, he's a tough, strong horse, and we were just beaten by a better horse, but she'll live to fight another day.
It was a great run. Frank's prepared the horse superb. He felt great. We all thought, well, I did as well, thought he was a bit more of a wet tracker type horse, but he's got some speed, and I would have liked a little bit more room in the straight to really get at him, but he's fought really hard on it. So take nothing away from Julius, that was a great win. Just maybe second or third would have been nicer.
This mare, she's run super. A little bit disappointed and pretty gutted, you know, we didn't get a fair crack at them at the top of the straight. If she gets out, not saying she wins, but she'll make it very, very interesting. Unfortunately, we'll never know, but she's on the way up, and I think she's a chance of ticking off another big race.
Really good. Ended up getting a perfect run. So probably took the speed out of it enough from a half mile to the turn when once everyone got their spot to make it hard to get over the top of them. Full credit to the winner, though. She ran well, though.
She was a little bit disappointing. Like, had a lovely spot, one off, and she's just lacked her sprint today, so we're not too sure what's wrong.
So that was the beaten jockeys in behind Julius. As we mentioned, the Telegraph market, you touched on a few of these, but just the prices now. Closer, Winter Bride, into fours.
Yes, so Volpe Veloce is probably the no on that page. Winter Bride, not so sure second up's going to be her go down the dog leg at Trentham. I think $4 is really, really short for her. Avantage is the horse I want to be on. I think she's had the perfect prep. A lot of horses coming out of the railway going into the Telegraph. It hasn't been uber successful in the last 10 years, that pattern. So, yeah, Avantage for me. I think missing yesterday for her is good. And Bostonian, as I said, Tony Pike expects to go. He's aiming to go, but he might change his mind if the track's looking like it could be too firm. So just maybe hold off on him at this stage.
We can now move along to a little bit of a low point on the day yesterday from the carnival with regards to the false start. There's plenty to talk about around this. Here's a look at the vision. So there you go. You can see Pin Me Down is still in behind on the right-hand side of your screen. The rest of the field has jumped.
Yeah, so a lot of confusion based around this. This is obviously a false start. Pin Me Down didn't get into the gates at any stage. So some of the jockeys here didn't hear the siren to say that, OK, this is a false start. So they are getting on with their job, which you would do if you didn't know what had happened. One of the people who did hear it was Leith Innes, and we see him there. There's Platinum Invader, who wins the rerun, and Leith is pulling up first. He's heard the siren, he is giving up. Also, some horses don't pull up as easy as others.
Yeah.
So a lot of confusion here. George is commentating, and he still thinks it's a false start, and some of the jockeys are cottoning on to this, and others are going further into the back straight. So we'll get to what happened next before we get to how it happened in the first place. What happened next was all the horses were going back to the start where the vet had to look over them all. The stewards then rang the vet and said, OK, these are the horses who have travelled the furthest, so these are the ones we want you to look at first. So that was done. Now, the horse who wasn't vetted was Roger That. He was found to be not good in his action, so the jockey said, look, this horse can't start. They got off him. Roger That was scratched without being inspected by the vets. They went back to the start, and Sentimental Miss and Just Amaze were both looked at by the vet, and I spoke to Neil, who was the race day vet there. He said their breathing didn't come back quickly enough, so they weren't going to give you...
They were the last horses to pull up.
Exactly.
I was at the mile, and Just Amaze couldn't be stopped. She, in fact, went all the way around and did a full lap.
Yeah, and once they were breathing that way, they can't get back into normal breath for 2,400 metres, so they had to be scratched, and that absolutely sucks for their connections. David Green, the trainer of Just Amaze, was very philosophical about it. He was very mature about the whole process because mistakes happen, and that's how it happened. So those two horses had to be scratched, and that money was refunded. Roger That was scratched because they believe he wasn't very good in his action. The others go back in the gate. We have Take Two, which is won by Platinum Invader. How did we get to this point? Well, the starter at Ellerslie, and for most of the Northern meetings, is Trevor Harrison, who's tremendously respected. And I had a really long talk to Trevor. He was absolutely devastated, and as you would be. Here's what happened. He said he was looking at Pin Me Down, and he was keeping it in his line of sight, and then two horses reared up in the gates, and he changed his line of sight to look at the horses rearing up. When he's looked back to Pin Me Down, Pin Me Down's been behind the Clerk of the Course's horse, and he's lost sight of it. So he's looking there, look, here's my horse, here's the gates, go back, okay, it's no longer there, it must be in, pushes the button. But it's not. It's behind the Clerk of the Course's horse. He's obstructed. He just made a mistake. He hasn't lied. He hasn't blamed anybody. He hasn't blamed a malfunction on the gates. He said, I made a mistake. Then there's been a secondary mistake. The protocol in that situation, I believe, I've been told yesterday, is that the race should be run and then the stewards and club can deal with the horse who was left behind, who would be deemed the late scratching. Trevor said to me, I thought that horse deserved its opportunity. So in the heat of the moment, which, and you wouldn't have very long to think about this, pushed the button for the false start. That puts the siren and the race can't continue after that, which had the scenes we just saw then. Then we go back to the start again, two other scratchings, plus Roger That, they all come out. We rerun the race. Trevor felt dreadful.
Oh,
he was absolutely beside himself.
Yeah.
And he's a guy who used to be a jockey. He's been starting for 15 years, and he was very apologetic to everybody. And he apologised to the club officials, and then he stood himself down from the remainder of the day, so he didn't start the last two races. And he was talking afterwards about the fact that he's looking long-term at maybe this was going to be his last year starting. But it's easy to lose perspective on this. It was a stuff-up, and it happens, but it's no different to you or me backing a car into the fence coming out of the driveway.
I think it's really...
pushing a button on a computer that's
wrong.
Well,
and if I read out the wrong odds, you know... there's no detrimental effect to anybody, but in his case, it has an effect. And as you said, it is just human error, and it's really important to focus on. We did a rough calculation. I think it was, you know, maybe 15,000 races that he'd started, and if you've made one mistake, geez, you're going pretty good, aren't you?
Well, look, it could have happened in a maiden race at Taupo a couple of days earlier, and I wouldn't have known, you might have known, and we would have watched it and gone, okay. It happened on the biggest stage, and that's really unfortunate. And again, I don't want to be flippant about the connections of Just Amaze or Sentimental Miss, because they've lost their opportunity for this race, and that really sucks. That's brutal. But it's one small error, which was followed by another error, and we're talking both of these happening in the space of 10 seconds. So it could happen to anybody, no different to making a mistake and just in general life. I feel for Trevor because he's such a nice man, and he felt so bad about it. And I think everybody was shocked, and there was a little bit of anger, and their perspective starts to come into it, and people start to go, because they're confused.
Yep.
Initially you're confused and you know what to do, but I think now people are going, okay, these things have happened.
On the big scale of things,
exactly,
nobody's died.
Exactly.
We can all come back. There's going to be plenty more races. It's not ideal, but
On a racetrack end, people can get hurt. Horses can get hurt. We can lose horses. Those things are far more important. So I think there was a nice deal of perspective from David Green. We saw a tweet from him this morning where he said, look, you know, this happened and we've had a good campaign and it wasn't great, But this is good. It's good from David to show some maturity, because he would have been hurting more than anybody else.
And out of anybody in the race, you know, he's one person who could have been frustrated, but he's not the best set of offers. Hard luck to future punters, but the horse is fine. Worst things will happen in life. People make mistakes. Turn the page. Happy New Year. And I think that pretty much sums up, and I hope that sums up how most people can look at this situation, you know, looking back at the day.
Look, and if you're a friend of Trevor's and everybody at the races, now, I don't know him that well, but I like him. Just, you know, give him a text, ring and see where he is. I hope this isn't the last time he starts a race.
No, it's a...
I hope that even if he does want to resign in the future or retire, because he's been doing it a long time, I hope he comes back and starts another meeting. And then the club can say goodbye and say thank you, because that shouldn't be, Trevor, the last time you started a race, because that's not indicative of your career. Now, Craig Baker, who is the racing manager at Ellerslie, also had a few words to say about how they were going to try and compensate those horses who were worst affected by the false start.
Yeah, absolutely, Mick. We're absolutely gutted for those that are scratched, but also those that raced, and we're also disadvantaged by the fact that they galloped an extra probably 1,000 metres. So I've just been talking to Bill Thurlow, and in terms of Beyond the Fort, and she hasn't pulled up that well, and he's going to put her in the paddock. So, yeah, those three horses that were late scratched, we're going to refund their nomination and acceptance fees, and also provide compensation around their travel costs as well.
Okay, it's been a wonderful carnival apart from that minor incident, which obviously was regrettable. We still have some pretty big racing coming up in January. It's going to come around pretty quickly, the Karaka Million.
Yeah, no, absolutely. We're 25 days away from Karaka Million night, so two $1 million races, plus also having Catalyst here as well will be a big advantage for us, and Melody Bell's going to gallop between races as well, so should be a great night.
Well, that pretty much sums it up, doesn't it? And hopefully we can leave it there, and as David Green said in his tweet, turn the page and move along.
Probably the one person who copped it better than most was Lisa Latta. She lost one of the favourites for the race, and then about 4 minutes later, that pain would have been a bit easy to swallow. She's a big girl. She'll understand the rules, and she knows these things can happen. And look, she'll be disappointed for Go Racing, but this is what actually happened by the time they ran the race the second time around. And Platinum Invader's a pretty darn good horse, and I think Leith being smart enough to pull him up really quickly, because Leith's a pretty smart dude.
He was onto it straight away. Saw him veering out down the straight. Let's have a little look back at the City of Auckland Cup.
3:50 to go. Artiste in front from Platinum Invader. Two lengths away, the Good Fight looks to warm up, followed in by Pin Me Down, then Concert Hall, but it's Platinum Invader in front. Sebiong Blanc's weaving its way through from the Good Fight and Artiste, but it's all Platinum Invader, and Lethan is here, and Platinum Invader will win the Sky City of Auckland Cup. Second, Sebiong Blanc from the Good Fight.
Lethan, I'm sure you haven't seen too many races like that in your time.
No, I sort of realised the horse wasn't in the gates, and as soon as they hit the buzzer, I sort of was probably one of the first ones to pull up. So he's been going really good races, been knocking on the door, and I was pretty confident coming in today. Got a little bit worked up before the start, but once he's in the race, I couldn't get in halfway down the straight, so I had to drop him back, but he got there nice and early, but he's too good.
Well done.
Cheers, eh?
One of the things we've heard from Lee then is he was aware that there's a horse that wasn't out the back and was able to pull the horse up early the first time. I guess it's affected you with losing Sentimental Miss, but in the end, all's well that ends well, eh?
Yeah, definitely. Look, it is frustrating that, travel the horses and you feel for the three horses that did get late scratch. You know, James didn't hear the siren and got all the way around to the 1,000, but like you said, he did get pulled up early, and it was a good ride by Lee.
The horse was here running third in New Zealand Derby last year, and he's been progressing really nicely, hasn't he? You must have come here with decent confidence today.
Yeah, I was very confident with the two of them, and obviously, you know, he still had improvement in him from the Manawatu Cup, and he's still, you know, he's on his way up.
Yeah, what do you do with him from here?
Look, we'll probably look at the Karaka Stayers and then the Auckland Cup. That was always our aim.
Yeah, how satisfying today, Lisa?
Oh, very.
Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you.
A nice win by the Lisa Latta trained runner. It probably, Michael, wasn't a horse that was on my radar. A little bit of time between wins and I wasn't sure. I thought it might run a good race, but I wasn't expecting it to win. But I suppose in the circumstances, it's mapped out beautifully.
Yeah, and third in a derby is great form for these type of races when you get it on a light weight. The whole race has been odd. The week's been odd with this race. They raised the weights 2.5 kilos. Mm. So a lot of horses who are on 53 ended up on 55.5. But he's absolutely smashed it. I don't know what to make of the form in behind because I'm not sure who was poorly affected by the false start and what it all means heading forward. So, look, it was a good win. He's probably got an Auckland Cup type performance in him somewhere. A horse like Concert Hall and Pimby, I don't really know what to make of their form. And I think there's a willing to forgive around quite a lot of them. So, some beaten jockeys in behind who are probably, to be honest, a little bit shell-shocked.
Yeah, it was a massive run. Drew wide. I wish we went in the first race because I was going to land in a better spot than I did in the second time round. So got probably too far back, hit the line really well, sort of coming into the straight. I was still travelling and by that stage the winner had got away on us. So there's something, there's a good race in her sights.
How much did the false start affect your chances?
It probably only affected mine sort of when we got into the next race, because I know she may have got a fright or something, I'm not sure, but she pulled really hard that second time round, so I would say that probably had some sort of effect.
Look, he's run super. End up getting a beautiful run, handier than what I thought, with a couple of scratchings, obviously, pre-race, but he's travelled beautifully, come into it, let down. I was never going to win, but I thought I was going to run second, and probably just the last 100 to 50 metres, he's just peaked late, just been sort of second up. But he'll improve heaps. He's a very nice stayer.
How much did the late the hold up and the restart, the false start, affect your horse?
For me, nothing at all. My horse is such a gentleman. He, as soon as we heard the siren, he was at a walk by the winning post, and then around at the gates, he stood there like a lamb. So he's a proper gentleman. So there was no real effect to that.
She jumped good and put herself in early posse. Probably first time past the post, I thought, oh, she's a little bit buggered, but I had to get out this half mile and just on the back of Yemenia, just to give her a nice and easy run into her. Probably wait till I straighten up to just let her go, but she didn't have that sprint at the end.
Yeah. How much was that false start affecting your horse?
Oh, hugely. That first pass, first time, she used a lot of sprinting. It showed at the 400.
Some really interesting comments there from the jockeys. Here's a little look ahead at the Wellington Cup market, and I guess we don't know a whole lot from that last race,
so
it's almost like a rerun while we get to see them all again.
Yeah, look, Gorbachev won the other day, obviously. Sauvignon Blanc I thought was really good. He can't take anything away from the winner. But I think this is a race we'll let percolate for a while and mature, and we'll see who turns up there and what the track's like, how hard the track gets at Treadthin. But I tell you, a horse who just talking about cups heading forward, the horse who wins the Dunstan Feeds, we'll see in a second, in Paisley Park, is outstanding. Spoke to Graham Richardson this morning. Now, Dunstan Feeds winner may be a late nominee for the Auckland Cup, so it's not on the market for the Auckland Cup, but it could be a late nom, and I thought it was one of the wins of the day yesterday.
It sure was. As we get you off to a break, we can have a little look at Paisley Park in the closing stages.
In behind them, Dance Card. Swords Drawn desperately needs room. We're shut out of a gap there at the 150. It's Paisley Park, the leader, coming after Spring Delight. Dance Card, Joe's Legacy flying to Stephen James and Lincoln King. Paisley Park, McDonald's doing it again.
What you think about that? Now you know how I feel. Say you can handle my love. Are you sorry? I'm
shots of the action from Ellerslie yesterday. As promised, we're going to get into the rest of our reviews. We're going to kick things off with the Auckland Guineas. Let's have a little review of the race.
Looking to run on now, Dragon Leap down the outside, coming with it, Star of Bombay. Riodini pushed the button, Dragon Leap ranged up on the outside, Star of Bombay is still there, Dragon Leap took the lead, Riodini's been popped the question, the two big guns go to war, but it's Dragon Leap, and you know who on top, Dragon Leap beat Riodini.
A performance like that, how special?
Yeah, oh, very special, Aiden. You know, it's sort of, you know, when you sort of, you know, you've got great owners and they outlay a lot of money and, you know, have a crack to buy a nice horse, you know, for them to come out and do that, you know, it's a great thrill for myself, Andrew Scott and all the team at Wexford.
Yeah, and we talked about that education here at Ellerslie, and didn't it pay off?
Well, absolutely. In fact, Andrew travelled up here about 12 days ago and he, you know, took the horse up and back, I think, three times past the winning post to let him have a look at it. And as he said at the time, let's hope next time we've got a problem, we are looking at the winning post first. But he's sort of one of those horses. He's a, you know, slow maturing horse, and there's no doubt, you know, in the autumn he's going to be a far better horse.
James McDonald giving him a big rap on just saying how much talent he's got. I guess you already knew that.
Well, I think we saw a talented horse, an extremely talented jockey. You know, we've all watched James right here over the carnival, and he's probably the greatest jockey New Zealand's ever produced. And you know, we've had some great ones. We've had the Jimmy Cassidys and Shane Dyes, and you know, he just might be the best of them all.
Yeah, there's one Lance O'Sullivan you can add to that list as well. Now we're safely through this, can you start planning about how you get there? Does Levin Classic come part of that or not?
Look, we looked at it, and you know, even if today wasn't to run today, we talked about it with Andrew this morning. You know, for some reason the races didn't go ahead today, would we go to Levin? And we decided against it. We thought he just didn't need a trip away. So no, that's not on the radar. But just how we plan to get to the Derby, we just have to work it out.
James McDonald was really bullish after the race about the win of Dragon Leap. He looks like a progressive horse. He looks like a horse that has any amount of ability, and fantastic to see him run a true race. He's learned so much from his previous start.
Here he has, and he looks like the favourite for the Derby too, doesn't he? Because
yeah,
he was so strong to the line. I remember when they bought this horse in Sydney, I thought to them, boys, calm down. $1,000,001, that's a lot of money. Look, it's a lot of money to buy a horse and bring it back into New Zealand. But
geez, he looks every bit $1,000,000.
He's
a beautiful animal. Yeah.
He is. And as you said, James was absolutely jumping up and down. Really strong win. Absolutely no pot of any sort on him. Not going to the Levin Classic, as you just heard. So I would suggest probably heads through Avondale Guineas or Waikato Guineas to make it here for the February 29th. His favourite, obviously, 2.8,
so
it's a bit short.
Yeah.
Holy Mongol Emperor was really good yesterday.
Mm.
He's a dopey bugger.
Opie say he just hits a flat spot for about 250 metres and then he gets motoring. But if he does that, that just puts him at such a disadvantage.
It almost doesn't seem to matter what distance he races over. He
no,
seems
I
to
know.
Hit a flat spot.
Yeah.
Sherwood Forest was really good too. He will head potentially to the Levin Classic.
Scorps is one for me.
Yeah, Scorps is a good staying type, isn't he?
$12.
Now, a couple of factors here. Riodini won't be in the Derby, so ignore him at $18. Now, I thought he was actually really good yesterday. I thought he almost jumped too well for his own good, and Sam ended up in the trail, and then she had to lead the field up to them and left herself a sitting duck for Dragon Leap, and she had no other choice. What else could she do? I spoke to Nigel Tolley this morning. He thinks that he's not a true long-term 1,600-metre horse, maybe a 1,400-metre horse, but they've got no other targets. So they're going to head to the Levin Classic. Nigel said as long as he pulls up well, next couple of days, they are still going to head to Trentham to take on Travelling Light and Harlech. So that's going to be a really good race. He wasn't disappointed, just probably a couple of factors went against him, but two very good horses there. Holy Mongol Emperor worth following, and the third horse, the filly, was excellent too. So lots of form out of that race to be strong. But most importantly for the punters, Riodini is still at this stage heading to Trentham.
Let's move along to the Royal Stakes, and it was a pretty dominant victory for Two Illicit.
The LaCoy looks to hunt her down. Further back in the field, then as they head for home, is Bergamot. It's Two Illicit at the 200 metres. Leads by two from Bergamot. Lilacoy running on late. Next, Coco Bachi and then Darcy Q. Two Illicit and Vincent Colgan in front from Bergamot and Lilacoy. She's too good. She gets a well-deserved win. And Two Illicit too good. Second over was Bergamot from Lilacoy.
I've got Vinny here beside me. He said I was unlucky in the pre-race interview. You can take that back now, Vinny.
Yeah, absolutely. Really deserved to win today. You know, it's just a little bit unlucky second on Boxing Day. But look, Rob just had a good look. And Rob and Emily Farr does all the work on her. Had a perfect one today.
a few race sort of changed complexion midway through, didn't it, when the speed came out of it?
Look, they did dawdle the race, but sort of half mile, the three wide train started, so I tagged onto it. We ended up in the front a bit soon because of that, but yeah, great stamina and kept going to the line.
Brent, to win on these big days when you've bred and developed these horses, Group 2 is great, isn't it?
Oh, fantastic. You know, it's a great testament to Roger and Robert. They've done a wonderful job, and the team back at the stables to have this filly here. Been four times relative, three wins in a second. So she loves it here, and we love coming here.
Yeah, absolutely. Today, what sort of confidence levels were you coming to the races with?
Oh, well, you've got the odds-on favourite. It's pretty tough, you know. It's fantastic to be in that position, but she ran well today. I'm really very happy with her.
It's an interesting run race, Vinny, just saying that they did dawdle, but she was able to quicken really nicely and put it away. It is encouraging going forward, isn't it?
Oh, for sure. You know, she's a filly that sort of went into a start of three-year-old with promise like they all do, but she's really stepped up and done particularly well, and I like the way that she actually relaxed in the run, even though the pace was quite slow, and then she's been able to quicken off them and got a left in front a long way out and found the line really well, which is great.
Okay, you know the family, you know the pedigree, can she get the oats?
Well, she's only three once, we'll find out. It's either in New Zealand or it'll be somewhere anyway.
I'm a big fan of Tourlisset, and I was really delighted that she could show how good she was and just looked like she was crying out for the 2,000 metres, and to see her dominate like that.
And back up in 6 days too.
Yep.
So look, she's going to race up the leaderboard for the Filly of the Year series. Jennifer Eccles beat a fair and square in the 8 carat, but they're both heading to the Oaks.
That was over a shorter distance.
Agreed. Yeah, she looked more like a 2,000 metre horse. Fascinating story by Jimmy Chu, who now is in WA. Spoke to John Thompson about Jimmy Chu. I said, what happened there? He said, we got five outside mares this year. They've got Tourlisset and Bostonian. They got five outside mares at about $7,000, and they said, so we sold them to WA. It's an amazing story. Admittedly, Rich Hill would now got Prasir, who's doing a good job.
Yep.
Here's the Oaks Market, and Loire and Tourlisset very much look like they're going to be horses who will get the Oaks distance. Jennifer Eccles, Sean's going to try and get the Oaks distance. Lilikoi was good yesterday, but lots of moving parts to happen there. So
I wonder if we were just talking, would Tourlisset have a line-up in a derby? I mean, Roger James has done it before.
Well, it's beaten Dragon Lee, who's favourite for the derby, albeit when the other one went a bit troppo in the previous race. But really, really good race with plenty of good staying blood coming through. But 2.5.3 muddling pace. Vinny summed it up beautifully. The ride was inch perfect. He rode it like the best horse, and she was.
Yep, she sure was. Let's get you along to the two-year-old race, which is the Eclipse Stakes. And a little bit of an upset here. It was sort of looked like a given that Not an Option was going to be able to dominate, but it was, in fact, Play That Song who was able to salute. What did you make of this one? Well, some real interference there early.
Yes, a real interference. And look, Not an Option had so much hype on it and the money was on, but he just crabs around the corner here. So he's in the Cambridge Stud Colours in fourth place, and he comes around the corner and he gets on the wrong leg and he just gets a little bit lost. And Play That Song, the filly, she just went straight past him. Now, he keeps coming, Not an Option.
His chance, I did feel, though.
Yep, I agree. Look, he was very brave. He kept coming. But the other filly might be really good.
I spoke to Leith after the race, and he said that he thought the horse was perhaps better the other way round. But he said he had his chance. I don't think that's it for Not an Option. I'm sure there's plenty more to come. You don't look as flash as he does or win like he did at Trentham without having plenty more up the sleeve to be able to push on.
Look, I'm sure he'll go to the Karaka Million. Now, interesting talk this morning to Nigel Tolley. They paid $40,000 for this filly because they tried to buy a showcasing colt, and they keep getting beaten for the ones they wanted. So they bought a filly, which they don't tend to do a lot of. She's really good.
Mm.
Not really, really good. Let's not just talk about Not an Option.
Yeah.
Now, James McDonald told me after the race that he wants to come back and ride this at the Karaka Million. Gary Cossey, his New Zealand manager, rang Nigel this morning and said, yes, James wants to come back. He intends to come back, but it can't be guaranteed. So Nigel said, well, if that happens, we're going to need to find another rider. So this is James McDonald's Karaka Million ride if he comes back.
Which would give punters a lot more confidence, I'm sure.
And I think he will.
Yeah.
I think he'll be here. Mick D is also coming back for Karaka Million as well. But there's just that little question mark just over what's going on in Sydney. Thought the top two were both good, but clear points victory to the filly.
And you can only beat what's in front of you, and maintaining that unbeaten picket fence record is hard, but that's what she's doing. She's winning.
For a filly, three in a row. Mm. And also she gets the weight relief, of course, heading into the Karaka. She'll carry 2 kilos less. Cool as a Bell, by the way, races Sunday week.
Which is a tried and tested path.
Yeah, very much so. The race Avantage went through, and that all those sort of Tiaka horses. So, really big push there over what James does. That's the big question now for this market, I would suggest, before the barrier draw, of course.
Richie O'Mahle was another feature on the program. It's a pretty highly sought after race, and Prix de Fer has sort of announced himself on the scene as being one of the most progressive horses around at the moment.
This was a masterstroke from Jamie Richards. This is a horse who they think is a 2,000 metre horse, and Jamie said to me a month ago, I'm going to freshen him up, keep fresh legs in him, do what On the Rocks did last year. He paid a compliment to Pam Girardi. He said, Pam did this last year with On the Rocks, I'm going to do exactly the same thing.
Mm.
And it's worked inch perfectly. Mick D was in on 53 because, of course, Opie couldn't ride the horse at that weight. A lovely ride. They're not going to head to the Thorndon Mile at this stage, so okay. No Thorndon Mile for him. More than likely, back up in distance. Go back up to the Herbie Dyke.
Okay.
So more than likely the Herbie Dyke for Prix de Fer, but that was a beautiful bit of training from
Jamie
Richards.
And Jamie's really good at that, being open to observing what other people do and taking that on board.
He's very deep thinking, Jamie. Mm. For a young man, he's very deep thinking, very serious. He must work a lot.
I think he does. I think he works very hard. No, it was a really good run by Prix de Fer.
Well, look, and also the weights helped, obviously, 53. But yeah, the Herbie Dyke at 2,000 metres, I think, is going to be quite an open race. The weight for age ranks aren't really strong. So there's so many horses there, and we're thinking, where are they all going next? And we'll try and keep people updated because we have another weigh-in in about 10 days' time. But that Trentham Carnival is going to come around pretty darn quick.
It is. What was your win of the Auckland Carnival?
Probably Dragon Leap, only because I love the Julius story. It's just such a gorgeous story. But Dragon Leap's the horse you're now thinking, how good's this? This might be really good. But there was a lot of highlights. It was a great carnival. What about you?
Yeah, I was just thinking there. I know he's going to ask me this. What am I going to say? Julius, I think, because I sort of got to know the story, and just a comeback like that is to be able to, and for such a big, heavy horse, to be able to race at that level, it's pretty remarkable.
Now, we have a weigh-in on Sunday week, but you're not going to be here because you're going to the Magic Millions to play polo.
Well, not just to play polo. I'm playing...
But you're going to play polo,
aren't you? I'm playing polo on Sunday.
So tell me about your polo game.
Well, it's a...
celebrity, isn't it? Say the
I'm not going to say it.
Celebrity polo game.
I'm the very bottom of the 24 people that have been invited.
Is Frankie Dettori playing?
He is. Hugh Bowman, James McDonald, James's partner Caitlin.
Are you going to come back, or are you going to be too famous after
this to come back for us?
You're going to come back.
Yeah, but I'm looking forward to it. Actually, there's the sales on the week and then the races on the Saturday, so hopefully I'll be able to bring back some interesting information.
Well, what else is coming up is, by the way, good news, Kamara's been saved. The pigs didn't win. They dug up the track, but Kamara has been saved. But we're going to have a weigh-in on Sunday week. Bernard Saundry is going to join us to talk about how NZTR is trying to inform you and clubs and everybody involved in thoroughbred racing about the racing bill, because a lot of people don't understand it. So Bernard's going to have an interview on the show next week to explain that while you're on the Magic Millions playing polo with big friends. And then obviously we get into the Wellington Cup Carnival. And before February, so before the end of the month, we're going to talk to Dean McKenzie, the boss of Rita, about this racing bill, Em, and try to explain to people what all this means, because it's really heavy stuff. So that's serious stuff we're going to have over the next month before the submissions are made to the select committee for those people in racing who want to get involved. So we'll try and keep you informed as best we can.
We'll do the best we can. So I'm away, obviously, the next Sunday, and Michael's here, though. And
I'm going to Kamara.
You'll see Michael live from Kamara. And then the following week, I think you're away, Michael, and I'm here. So a little bit of a mix-up in the coming weeks, but we'll be back with you for the rest of January as we build into that Wellington Carnival and then, of course, Karaka Million. But for us this morning, we say a very good morning.